Boom, and we continue the show with our next panel. This one is called Music NFTs, how they're radically be changing the artist fan experience. I'm very, very intrigued. And coming back from yesterday to moderate this panel, please welcome the panel and moderator, Tommy D.
What's up, everybody? Let's get some energy back in the room, right? How we doing? Not long now, not long now. Who was here till 3:30 in the morning like me and Sarah DJing out there? Who was here? Who was here? Hands up. No, I'm surprised that no one is here from 3:30 in the morning. Hi, everybody. If you missed me yesterday, my name is Tommy D. I'm a music producer, a songwriter, a DJ, an artist, and a whiskey maker. And I'm also, since 2020, the tech entrepreneur, the founder of the music company Token Tracks, which uses Web3 tools to revolutionize the music industry. Yesterday, I talked about community and how the music industry can teach you, well, everybody in this room, about the concept of what community really means. It means fans. Fans, that's what it means, and fans give you support. So today we are very, very lucky to be joined by four incredible artists that are doing incredible things here in NFT, and some of which performed yesterday. Me and Sarah DJed last night. Emma played yesterday. I'm gonna let them introduce and talk to themselves, but please, give a big hand for the panel, please. Big hand for the panel, music artists. Thank you, guys. Sarah.
Hi, I'm Sarah Main. I've been in the music industry for coming on 30 years now, so I've watched the changes over that time. I'm in the electronic dance music industry. Just before the pandemic, I'd sort of been getting disillusioned with everything for quite a few years, and I decided to transition back into my art as I'd studied fine arts at university. And then the pandemic hit, so it was sort of like divine timing. And also the pandemic gave me the opportunity to dive deep into crypto, which led me to Web3 and NFTs, and I started releasing my art as NFTs. And then I realized that this was a space that would bring all my creative pursuits together. So I got extremely excited. So I had my art, then I got back into my music, and I'd also studied interactive multimedia, is what they called it when I studied it. So animation and graphic design. And then earlier this year, I released my first music NFT with Token Tracks, which was a wonderful experience. And it was a hybrid release, so I released on the normal Web2 platforms and then released as an NFT as well. It was a wonderful experience, which led me to create another project called Data Veda, which really is such a passion project of mine. It's the music was mixed in Dolby Atmos. It's more like an ambient soundscape, and from that I got inspired to create a storyline. So it comes with a 9-chapter storybook, which then I created an AI animation to go with the song that relates to the storybook, and the storybook comes alive with augmented reality. And that's what I'm currently working on, plus a whole heap of other stuff. Yeah, it's nonstop, but it's a really exciting space, and I'm very, very honored to be here with Tommy and with these wonderful artists who I really look up to. I'm a relative newcomer in comparison to these guys, so I always look to them to learn and get inspired.
Excellent. Emma?
Lovely. My name is Emma Miller. I'm from Scotland. I'm an independent artist, and my journey into the Web3 space kind of happened actually through this nice guy on my left, Josh Savage, who invited me into some Twitter spaces. And for about 12 months, I was solidly performing every single day in spaces. And that is how I cultivated a community of collectors and started launching very small batches of music NFTs until my last collection, which is the largest to come from the UK, a 1,000 piece music NFT collection called Artifacts, around 5 original songs. And what I've really discovered over this last year is how little the public understand around independent artists and what is on offer for them in the current industry. If you don't know, it's 0.006 pence on average per stream for an artist. There's lots of, you know, pay-to-play models out there where there's no chance to develop young talent. But coming into the Web3 space, we've got this title of like a radical shift happening, because we have the opportunity for collectors to come in and really back the artists they believe in, and give them the opportunity to be part of their art, their music, and for the first time to own an asset as well. You're owning this digital asset. So I have a lot of my eggs in the Web3 basket, and I'm loving being fully submersed in exclusively at the moment releasing my music on the blockchain. I'll throw it to Josh.
Hi everyone, my name is Josh Savage. I'm a British indie singer-songwriter based in Berlin. I made my living from touring, primarily back in the day. Then of course pandemic hits and I have to figure out how am I still gonna make this music thing work. I explored Web3. I started Web3 by performing Twitter Spaces and building, well, just making friends primarily, especially in the lockdown in Germany. There was nothing else to do anyway. And it was an absolute game changer, because I was literally about to do a coding course to try and make ends meet. And suddenly when I was dropping music NFTs, people were buying my music, which in my mind was like, this is mad, because people haven't really bought music in a while. And I learned that people want to be a part of my journey in a bigger way, and I had a much bigger connection with my fans. My connection with my fans on Spotify were non-existent after when touring wasn't an option. And thanks to that, I managed to build and grow. I eventually sold my Love Letters collection of 888 pieces, which was like a new revolutionary way I released an album, and added a ton of utility, such as like free tickets to shows, even me writing a custom song for you. And that allowed me to reinvest in myself, create new songs, but also got to tour with some amazing artists like Robbie Williams in front of 100,000 people, Snow Patrol, Bright Eyes, and some absolute legends that would not have been possible without music NFTs, because it's an investment. And what's really special is that I've been able to take my collectors every step of the way with that. So a music revolution is about to begin, and it's very exciting to be a part of that, and to be able to grow with my fans, rather than having to rely on middlemen who can take 80% of your upcoming revenue and often don't even have your best interests at heart. And what's really powerful about working with your fans is that you know they give a shit, and then you know they're with you through and through. And with Web3 technology, you kind of blur the borders between artist and fan. So yeah, that's me.
Amazing. And Alice?
Hi guys, I'm Alice, and I'm a visual artist and music artist from Brighton in the UK. And I was releasing music as an independent musician, mixed with releasing music with record labels such as Columbia Records and, you know, a few of the majors. But I kind of got to a point in my career with that where I had a song go viral on TikTok, and I was at this kind of moment of, okay, do I go back down this route or do I find other ways? And I'd been learning a bit about music NFTs and Web3, and just, but it hadn't really sunk in. And I saw a video, an interview with a Web3 artist called Latasha, and she was explaining how she was releasing music in this way and how it was serving her creativity. She wasn't feeling stifled anymore. She didn't have to answer to any kind of, you know, big wigs or anything. She was just completely doing her thing. And that kind of lit a fire in me. And after that point, I started researching heavily about Web3, and I knew nothing about crypto. I mean, I knew of it, but I'm not a very technically minded person. So I spent a couple of months kind of researching how it all worked and how it could, you know, how I could release music in that way. And about 7 months ago now, I came across Emma's Twitter space, And I started listening to that, tuning in every weekday. And Emma just had this really kind of, I want to say like a motherly presence for newbies coming in. And she really kind of helped me and others understand blockchain in a very kind of simple way and how it was, you know, working for her own release of music. So fast forward a few months, I released my EP Answers as an NFT collection, each song. And that sold out, which was cool. It took a lot of work, a lot of connecting. But through that, I met amazing people, have made friends through that. And yeah, here I am now, which I would not have expected. So that's my story.
Alex, I want to stay with you because you were signed to a major label for a period. How do you think that the difference between being signed as a major, because obviously the traditional route for most artists is to try and get signed to a major label. 9 out of the 10 of the top 10 singles of the last 15 years have been on a major label. So if you want to be, you want to have a hit single, you have to be signed to a major label. That's pretty much the rule, right? You were signed to a major label. You had a bad experience with that, like so many people that are signed to major labels, sadly. Coming out of that major label and sort of constructed system, how do you see in your eyes the way that the you know, the difference between the independent sector that revolves around music NFTs, how do you see that being different to the traditional sort of major label structure of being a musician?
Well, firstly, you have so much more say, well, you have all the say of what happens. And the main difference is there's no middleman, so you're directly connecting with someone that likes your music, you know. Before it would be like, you have to check in with, you know, your A&R, or you have to check in with a manager and be like, oh, should I do this? What's the next step? But with Web3, you're just directly conversing with people every day in a very personal way that like your music, and it takes it away from being kind of hierarchical to just, you know, horizontal, where you're just kind of on a level playing field with, you know, there's no difference between you as the creator and the person enjoying your music. So I would say that's the key thing, that the key experience that I have, you know, that I didn't have in a label. That's very, you know, you have to promote on Instagram, social medias and stuff. That's your interaction, but it's this kind of filter of contriveness, whereas when you're showing up in Twitter spaces or, you know, talking with the people that like your music every day, it's a human, you know, it's more human. So yeah, I'd say that's the main.
Yeah, I think the community aspect of the music, if you're not, for those that aren't familiar with the community aspect of music NFTs, it's really, really beautiful. It's a very, really strong community of people that really help each other and support each other. I know that NFTs in general, you know, is all built about communities, fans, whatever, the support network. But there is a lovely community within the music NFT community. If you want to check in on my Twitter space, I have the longest running music NFT Twitter space on Mondays at 6 p.m. UK. So you come and check in and hear the stories from artists like these guys about what they're up to. Josh, I want to come back to you. With the, you've been in this space now, I think, as one of the longest people who've been a sort of recognized music NFT artist, and you've done really, really well. How do you think you've done that? I mean, what was your game plan from the start with understanding the space? Because you, I would call you and Violetta and Sammy are quite sort of pioneers in the sense of defining PFP projects around the artwork, but also around the concepts of the music and the ownership. Perhaps you could explain a little bit about your project and then in relation to how that's become so successful.
Yeah, it's actually really funny when you put it that way, Tommy, because I've only been in the space for 18 months.
Oh, you're an old man.
Which is ancient in Web3, right? So that's one of the funniest things. And what's crazy is that the space evolves so quickly. When I was just on tour for 3 months, when I came back, I felt like I was 3 years out of date. So it's really important to stay in current with what's going on at the moment. And I'm very excited for Bitcoin Ordinals for that reason. Don't know how the hell you put music on it yet, but I'm definitely looking into it. And but to be fair, when you kind of jump into this space, I would say, don't even worry about a game plan straight away. The most important thing, something I said to Emma, just make friends, make connections. you can't sell an NFT if you don't have the demand for it first. So go out there, support other communities. Something Sammy does incredibly well is he actually invests in the community that he digs and has a good vibe with, and builds a very strong relationship with them, and then they end up absolutely adoring him and adoring how talented he is too, and then want to support him back. So I think that's the most important thing, really. Forget even that what kind of song you put out there, just make connections, make friends and relationships first before you even think about any of that.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great point. All four of these artists make very different types of music. So it's not really music orientated. You would think it would be electronic music, perhaps hip hop. And yeah, that is big in the music NFT space. But you can find your tribe here. This is the beauty of this space. You don't need to find that many people. How big is your community, Josh, of holders?
What's that?
How big is your community of holders that you have?
About 300.
Right, so 300. Now, you know, for anyone that came to my talk yesterday, 300 monthly listeners would be, you know, an absolute abomination. But 300 supporters of an NFT project is massive and can generate 10 times the money that, you know,
well,
3
yeah.
million monthly listeners would.
Well, yeah, now my Love Letters collection, which is like my album I initially released on Spotify, but it felt really heartless because it's just an MP3. What I did was hand make every single love letter with featured lyrics and then collectible audio of not just all 8 songs, but 3 different arrangements of each song too, and different kind of perks with some are like oil paintings instead of letters. And the thing is, when people initially minted it, they didn't know which one they're gonna get. And people are already making huge profits from love letters already, with one of the sales being initially minted at $100 and then reselling for $4,500. And it's, Wow. Yeah, and that's just really special to me, that people aren't just supporting me because they give a shit, but also they're actually making financial gain out of that too. So, as a creator, an absolute no-brainer to get involved. Of course, a huge learning curve, but it's really important to kind of get stuck in and learn this now before it gets oversaturated too, I think.
Yeah, and that's a great point, because first and foremost, you know, don't sleep on music NFTs, right? Because music is a thing. I said it yesterday. We all lose our shit to music. We're in a club, in a festival, in a gig, whatever. Even in our front rooms, we put a track on, we go, oh my God, this music is amazing, right? You don't really do that with anything else in your life apart from music. Music, you lose your shit to. So if you want adoption in this space, music is going to be that missile that can get right to the heart of people to make the difference and to work out what it is that they love. You connect that in with a blockchain experience without me even knowing about it. In Token Tracks, we have credit card, Google Pay, Apple Pay integration. We have custodial and non-custodial wallets with Polygon, Zilliqa, Bitcoin, and Ethereum. So a complete crypto newbie can come on to Token Tracks. That's a fan of, say, you know, Sarah's, can come onto Token Tracks with no experience of crypto at all. They can buy with their credit card, they can buy on Polygon so they don't know what the gas is, we create the custodial wallet for them. Their NFT appears right there in their wallet. They can just take that NFT straight within Token Tracks or Track Studio to a token gated area and unlock that area, and there's a performance of Sarah or a special DJ mix that Sarah's done just for the NFT holder. This is a complete 360 approach to engaging new people into this space. Okay, so don't sleep on music NFTs, because this shit is gonna blow up way, way bigger than I think anything else.
Can I add to that?
Yeah.
Well, you go first.
Okay.
No, add to that.
I was gonna say, like, this might be an unpopular opinion, but most NFT projects are completely vapid and soulless and full of empty promises. And I think most of the Web3 culture right now is kind of bullshit. But with music and artists, from the get-go, you're investing in a person, in a soul, in art. And really, that has been a ripple, because we've set the tone as us as people coming into the space. Our community has organically formed those same values. So we're attracting substance and heart and long-term holders within our projects, because they're also fed up of the NFT space and of just, yeah, really like not maybe being fulfilled with where they're putting their time, where they're putting their money. And I do come this from the music side, and I believe a lot of my holders, they're looking to be with me long term on this journey. But like Josh said, the game changer is you hold this asset and this moment in history. But I just wanted to make that comment that it's radically different. We keep using this word radical with the music scene within Web3. Whatever your experience has been of the NFT scene, come to the light and come to the music side, because I guarantee it will be a wholeheartedly different experience. And hopefully you can connect with some of us up here and come to our spaces, come to our live shows.
Emma does a great space. What time's your space? You do a regular one every week, right? Every day.
Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I host spaces. I think we're all in EST time, 8 a.m. EST, 1 p.m. UK or 1 p.m. Portugal time. And Friday is always an open mic. So if you're an artist or if you want to start your day with some music, come and hang out. But yeah, we all kind of are very present online and constantly talking about the space and trying to innovate. And
And Emma makes a really good point. You know, if you actually look at the data around NFT trade, music NFT trades, we've survived the bear market. It's just been doing this. It's going up like that. It's really, 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 really powerful. I mean, you heard Josh turning
out
over
in the bear market.
What's that?
Yeah. We minted out in the bear market.
Right. Both of them minted out projects, massive projects in a bear market. So music NFTs are a great investment for trading as well. But most importantly, you're actually supporting artists that are used to continuing to create value in what they're doing. One thing about music is, there's a great saying, which is, you're only as big as your last hit, right? Because it doesn't matter if I have a number one single next week, I need to have a number one single the following month and the following month and the following month to stay relevant. So music artists are programmed to keep coming up with innovation, keep coming up with good stuff, keep coming up with new projects. And that is, I think, transferring into the music NFT market, which means that these guys are constantly providing amazing utility in the form of their NFTs. So if you're a holder of the music NFTs, you constantly get stuff. I've been saying for a while, what the fuck are the blue chip NFT projects doing, like Yuga Labs? I mean, Yuga, not so bad. Azuki, I mean, what was that job the other day? I'm sorry to be controversial here, and if anyone from Azuki, apologies, but it was bullshit. You know, there's no utility in these guys. They're making shit ton of money. What are they doing with it, right? These music NFT artists are working 24/7, providing music, providing gigs, providing content, loads and loads of stuff. It is a value metric to be a music NFT holder. You get something. There's a guy just come in here. This gentleman here, he's driven all the way from Romania because he's a fan of Emma's, and Emma gave him a free ticket to the blockchain festival. He's driven all the way from Romania to be here to see Emma perform. Now that is dedication, and that is fandom, and that's what I'm talking about. You amplify that by 20,000%, then you've got adoption. Right, we've got 4 minutes to go. Sarah, I want to come to you, and then we're going to do a quick Q&A. If anybody's got questions. Sarah, you've been incredible with this lady is insane with her ability to bring in different things into what she's doing. Art, and that animation, music, DJing, so much incredible stuff comes out of Sarah. How have you used AI in your, we'll touch on this a little bit, how are you using AI in your NFT project?
I started with AI in 2020 with my art, and I fed in my collection of physical pieces and trained an AI on my actual art, and what it spat out was like sort of grotesque, but like really like artistic, and I felt like a real bond with the AI, and ever since then it sort of fascinated me. So with my Data Vader project, for example, I literally wrote the story with ChatGPT that when it first came out, I'm like, what's the first thing I can do? And that's the first thing I did. I created this whole story around Darth Vader, which are two galactic sound warriors traversing the galaxy using their sound waves for good. And then I used Midjourney as well, which fascinates me, to create the images for the chapters of the book. And then I used those as the anchor image to create the audio reactive animation in Kyber.ai, which is also really, really fascinating. And I'm constantly on the search for like new tools and new ways to expand my creative paths. Like for me, there's not enough hours in the day, and this time is extremely exciting for me creatively. So.
Yeah. it's incredible. So the Data Vader project is available along with many, many other projects on Token Tracks. It's a ton of amazing stuff. We have a project that we call Get Minted for any artists that are new to NFT music coming in. We've got an amazing label with this man here called Wild Awake. We have our curation set up now. We're encouraging artists to become curators themselves to help other artists come into this space. We believe that over the next sort of year to 18 months, we're going to see a massive influx of music artists coming into this space because of the incredible work that these guys have done on stage here in paving the way for this. We've got just over a minute left. Has anybody got any questions, any hands? Anyone want to find out a bit more about what we're doing? We got the Token Track stage out there. If anyone caught Elsie's performance yesterday, absolutely amazing. Emma's performance.
We've got Josh performing at 7 p.m. tonight. Yep. We've got Alice doing an incredible set after him, and these are like to get some, you know, respite, have a drink, come and find some shade, and come witness these guys because you'll have a great time.
Yeah, Mika's also playing outside. And we got a couple of DJs playing. So yeah, go and check out what we're doing at Token Tracks. Go and check out Sarah Main, Emma Miller, Josh Savage, and Alice. Everybody, round of applause, please.
Thank you.
Thank you.